Today, we're going to put on our economist hats and solve a puzzle. Now, this looks like a standard run-of-the-mill exam question, but it's got a hidden twist, a single real-world detail that changes everything. Think you can crack it? Let's find out. So here's the deal. I'm going to lay out a few key numbers for a small economy, and our goal is to calculate something called the money base. So follow along with me, and let's see if you can get to the answer before I do. Okay, so first things first, what exactly is this money base we're trying to find? Before we can calculate anything, we kind of need to know what it is we're looking for. To put it simply, the money base is the most foundational money in an economy. Think of it as the bedrock. It's all the physical cash, you know, in people's pockets, plus the reserves that commercial banks hold. It's the core stuff from which all other money gets created. Okay, let's get to it. Like any good puzzle, we need to assemble our clues. We've got a few key pieces of data to work with, and they're all going to lead us to that final answer. Our very first clue is the total money supply, which we'll just call M. So imagine all the money in this entire economy. Every coin, every bill, every single dollar in every bank account. It all adds up to 130. Now, out of that 130, we're told that 100 of it isn't physical cash floating around. Nope. It's sitting in bank deposits. We'll just label this D for deposits. Simple enough. Okay, now for the rules of the game. The central bank says there's a 25% required reserve ratio. What does that mean? Well, it means for every $100 a bank takes in from depositors, it has to keep 25 of it in the vault. It can't lend it out. It's the legal minimum. And here it is. This is our twist. This is the detail that trips up so many people. The banks, in our little economy, they're playing it safe. They aren't just holding the required 25%. They are holding extra cash in reserve, way more than the law demands. So how much more are we talking about? An extra 50? In the world of economics, this is what we call excess reserves. So just remember that. They have the legally required reserves, plus this extra voluntary buffer of 50. So let's dig into this trick, because it's not just a random detail for a test question. It's what banks do in the real world. But why? Why would a bank voluntarily lock up money that it could be lending out and making a profit on? It really comes down to one thing, a safety cushion. Think of it like a bank's own personal emergency fund. It's extra cash on hand for a rainy day, maybe a sudden rush of withdrawals or an economic downturn. It's a strategic choice they make for stability, not just a rule they have to follow. Okay, so let's break down the numbers here. The required reserves, that's easy. It's 25% of the 100 in deposits, which is 25. But the actual reserves, what's really truly sitting in the vault, is that required 25 plus that extra safety cushion of 50. That gives us a grand total of 75 in actual reserves. Okay, that distinction right there between required and actual reserves, that was the main hurdle. Now that we've got that sorted out, we have everything we need to finally solve for the money base. You know, this simple balance sheet shows exactly how it all works. On one side, the bank's liability is the 100 it owes to its depositors. And on the other side, its assets are the 75 in cash reserves plus the 25 it has loaned out. See? Everything balances perfectly. We are so close. We just need one final piece for our formula. The cash held by the public, or C. And this is exactly what it sounds like. It's all the physical cash that's not in a bank, but out there in the world, in wallets and cash registers. And finding this number? It's super simple. If the total money supply out there is 130, and we already know 100 of that is locked away in bank deposits, well, the rest has to be physical cash. So 130 minus 100 leaves us with 30 in cash held by the public. And now we have our master formula. The money base, which we'll call B, is simply the actual reserves, R, plus the cash held by the public, C. And this is the most important part, so listen up. We use the actual reserves of 75, not just the required 25. That is the entire key to this whole puzzle. All right, we've got our actual reserves, we've got our cash, we've got the formula. It is time to put it all together and finally solve this thing. The final money base for this economy is 105. So quick recap, how did we get there? Well, we took the actual bank reserves, which were 75, then we added the cash held by the public, which was 30, and that simple little bit of addition, 75 plus 30, gives us our final answer of 105. Now, if you found that a little challenging, hey, you're not alone. This is considered a difficult exam-level question for a reason. It's designed to test if you're just blindly following rules or if you're actually thinking about how the real world works.
So what's the big idea here? What's the main takeaway? It's that economics isn't just about textbook formulas and rules. To really get the right answer, you have to look beyond the official regulations and consider actual behavior. You know, the strategic choices that institutions like banks make every single day.
And that, of course, leads to a much bigger question. Now that you know the money base is built on bank reserves and public cash, how could a central bank start pulling the levers? How could changing things like interest rates or reserve requirements influence how banks behave and, in turn, speed up or slow down an entire economy? That's where a simple calculation like this becomes a really powerful tool. Thanks for diving in with me.